Hello and welcome back. You're watching Parry This. Last time we discussed the historical basis for the King Arthur legend in depth. If you haven't seen that and would like to, I strongly recommend it as it will provide the historical framework and to do a little to explain where all these fantastical stories originate from. But today we are going to be going through King Arthur's life according to the legends. So let's just dive on in and learn what the once and future King of Britain is all about. Arthur is known to be the son of Uther Pendragon. So we will start his tale there. Aurelius Ambrosius and Uther had been raised in Brittany since Vortigern was in power in Logres, otherwise known as Britain. When the brothers had reached manhood, they gathered a large army from Brittany to avenge their brother's death and drive out the Saxons. First, they turned their attention to Vortigern, whom had fled to his palace. The brothers set Vortigern's palace on fire, burning Vortigern to death. Aurelius became king and fought a series of battles against the pagan Saxons. Aurelius continued war against the remaining Saxons, led by Hengist's son, Octa. Octa was defeated and allowed to settle in Scotland. Aurelius Ambrosius set about rebuilding his kingdom. It was said that under Merlin's advice, he built the giant stone ring known as the Giant's Ring, or more commonly as the Stonehenge, by bringing the large rocks from Ireland. When Aurelius Ambrosius was poisoned during the war against Paschent, Vortigern's son, he was buried within the Stonehenge. Uther found out from Merlin about his brother's assassination when he was on campaign against Paschent and Gilomanius, the king of Ireland. Uther and Merlin saw a strange phenomenon in the night sky. They saw a comet streaking past two dragons flying in the night sky. Thereafter, the new king was named Uther Pendragon. Uther won a decisive battle at Menevia. Gorloy, the middle-aged Duke of Cornwall, was the man who devised a strategy to defeat Paschent and brought a great victory to Uther. Paschent and Gilomanius were killed in the battle. During the victory celebration in London, Gorloy brought his young and beautiful wife named Igraine. Uther fell instantly in love with the Duke's wife. Uther was so obvious about his lust that Gorloy left the celebration in disgust with his wife, without asking for the king's leave. Uther threatened war with Gorloy. The old duke ignored the king's warning, returned to Cornwall to organize his defense. Since Tintagel was his strongest castle, he left his wife there, while he went to fortify the undercastle. Uther had pinned Gorloy in this besieged castle. With the help of Merlin's magic, Uther took the form of Gorloy in appearance, while Merlin had transferred himself into Gorloy's steward, and Ulfin was transformed into Gorloy's chamberlain. Uther secretly went to Tintagel with Merlin and Ulfin under these guises, and entered the castle. Everyone in Tintagel thought Uther was Gorloy, even Igraine. Uther slept with his enemy's wife, and Arthur was conceived. That very night, news that the real Gorloy was killed in the siege of the other castle. Uther falsely convinced the people of Tintagel that he, or himself as Gorloy, was alive. He pretended to return to the other castle, but actually he returned to his own army in his own form. Uther learned the news of Gorloy's death to be true. Uther ordered all of Cornwall, including Tintagel, to surrender. Igraine, realizing that her husband was dead, surrendered the duchy to Uther. Uther was still in love with Igraine, and the king immediately married her the next day. Igraine was already pregnant with Arthur. A year later, Arthur was born. Igraine also gave birth to a daughter named Anna. According to Layamon, Arthur received many magical gifts from the fairies. They gave him the gift of courage, strength, wisdom, kingship, and long life. Uther adopted Igraine's two daughters, Morgoth and Morgan le Fay. Before long, Arthur was born, and quickly Merlin came to take him away. Merlin foresaw great evil coming to Britain. Soon after, Uther died from a traitor's poison, and Britain plunged into darkness. Over 10 years after Arthur was born, Uther faced another war against Octa, who left his exile in Scotland and attacked Logres. Octa was aided by Colgrim, king of the Saxons in Germany. Uther was ill at the time. Uther left the command of his army to Lot, whom his daughter Anna had married. Lot and Anna were parents of two sons, Gawain and Mordred. However, Lot was losing more battles than he was winning, so the ill and weary king went into battle with Uther in command. Octa and his cousin, Eosa, were defeated and killed in the Battle of St. Albans. Colgrim escaped and fled to York, where he rallied his forces. Later, spies of Colgrim poisoned the water in the well that Uther normally drank. Many people in Uther's household died from the poison, including Uther himself. Uther was buried beside his brother at the Giant's Ring. It is said that Merlin only aided Uther in gaining Igraine's hand on the condition that when Uther had his firstborn son, he would give him to Merlin. Merlin hid Arthur on the countryside. A gentle knight, Sir Ector Bonmason, adopted him. Sir Ector had another son named Sir Kay, and it is said that he loved them both equally. Arthur was the firstborn son of King Uther Pendragon, and the heir to the throne. However, these were very troubled times, and Merlin, a wise magician, advised that the baby Arthur should be raised in a secret place, and that none should know his true identity. As Merlin feared, when King Uther died, there was a great conflict over who should be the next king. Merlin used his magic to set a sword in a stone. Written on the sword in letters of gold were these words: "Whoso pulleth out this sword of this stone is the rightwise born king of all England." Of course, all the contenders for the throne took their turn at trying to draw the sword, but none could succeed. As fate would have it, Arthur accidentally stumbled upon the sword in the stone when he went looking for a sword for Sir Kay to use in his duel, because he lost Kay's sword. He easily pulled the sword out of the stone and took it to Kay. Astonished, Kay told Arthur to hide the sword from everyone and get Ector. Kay told Ector that he had pulled the sword and not Arthur. Ector told him to put it back. When the actual sword-pulling contest began, everyone got in line. When it was Arthur's turn, he easily pulled the sword out of the stone, just like before. Everyone was furious. The dukes and the kings didn't want to believe that Arthur was king, but he was. He was King Arthur, and he brought Britain out of the darkness. The sword that Arthur had pulled from the stone that would earn him the recognition of rightful heir to Uther Pendragon, as well as the king of all Britons, was named Clarent, also known as the Sword of Peace. This is the sword that Arthur would wield for several years, both in battle and while appointing knighthoods. This sword would be broken and discarded in a battle early in Arthur's career, and would be replaced by an even more famous sword later. It is said that the shards of the sword would be recovered from the battlefield and later reforged and carried by Mordred, Arthur's half-brother and lifelong nemesis. When Arthur became king, he set about constructing his seat of power, which would become known as Camelot. This legendary location is said to be a castled city with great curtained walls, battlements, and many tall towers. It is said to have rivaled cities like Paris and London in size and population, and would regularly host tournaments, fairs, festivals, and other such events. It was the capital of Arthur's Kingdom of Logres, and it is said here that Arthur would base his 150 Knights of the Round Table. King Arthur, on his quest to rid Britain of evil, met King Leo de Grance. He fell in love with his daughter, Guinevere. When Arthur married Guinevere, Leo de Grance gave Arthur a gift of 150 knights. The knights were used to form the first members of the Knights of the Round Table. They swore loyalty to King Arthur. They followed the code of chivalry and never betrayed Arthur, but that would change. There would be many Knights of the Round Table throughout Arthur's reign, but none more famous than the following 14 members, who all have their own stories and legends of heroic acts, chivalric feats, and honorable deeds that earned them their fame. In no particular order, their names are as follows: Sir Lancelot, Sir Gawain, Sir Galahad, Sir Geraint, Sir Gareth, Sir Gaheris, Sir Bedivere, Sir Ector, Sir Kay, Sir Bors de Ganis, Sir Lamorak, Sir Tristan, Sir Percival, and Sir Agravain. We will not get into most of the deeds and acts of all of these famous characters right now, as that would literally take all day. In the future, each of these knights will get their own video to fully explore what it is that made them so special. Behind Arthur's back, Guinevere was having an affair with Lancelot. She loved Lancelot more than Arthur, but feared what would happen if Arthur found out. They met in secret. Eventually, Arthur's knights and nephew, Mordred, found out about Lancelot and Guinevere. Arthur was furious. He wanted Guinevere burned at the stake. Lancelot betrayed Arthur and broke the code of chivalry. When Guinevere was about to be burned, Lancelot saved her and killed Gawain's brothers, making an enemy of Sir Gawain. The Pope demanded Arthur and Lancelot stop fighting. Lancelot returned Guinevere, and Guinevere was forgiven. Arthur chased Lancelot around Europe, and Lancelot hid in his kingdom in France for quite some time. It is during this time that both Arthur and Lancelot, although not together, would experience many of their most famous adventures, both taking the time off from their chase to attend jousting tournaments, rescue damsels in distress, go after legendary treasures, and defeat local warlords and miscreants tormenting the people of England. One day, Arthur was without a sword and was searching for one. This, of course, takes place sometime after the destruction of the famous Sword in the Stone. He then encountered a lake with a hand sticking out of it. The hand had the sword Excalibur on it. Arthur wanted the sword, so he rode out to it. He grabbed the sword and the Lady of the Lake appeared. She only asked that he repay the favor sometime later. Arthur obtained the sword Excalibur and would use it as his primary weapon for the remainder of his life. The sword was said to have many magical qualities, such as being indestructible, and being far lighter, stronger, and remaining sharp longer than even the best blades available. The scabbard of Excalibur is said to have protected Arthur from flesh wounds, likely saving his life on multiple occasions. While Arthur, his knights, and his army were away hunting Lancelot, he left Mordred in charge. Mordred wanted the throne and pretended Arthur was dead. He forged a letter saying Arthur was killed in battle and that Mordred was king. When Arthur heard Guinevere was hiding from Mordred, he came back quickly. He was met at Dover with Mordred's army. He defeated Mordred's army and landed at Dover. Around this time, Sir Gawain died, but only after he wrote a letter forgiving Lancelot. When Arthur was sleeping, he dreamed he would die at the Battle of Camlann. He proposed a treaty with Mordred, so he could focus on Lancelot. At the conference, a knight saw a snake and drew his sword. This sparked the battle between them. All the knights drew their swords and fought. Arthur rushed to Mordred with a spear and impaled him. Mordred climbed up the spear and hit Arthur on the head, and then fell back dead. Arthur was now fatally wounded. While Arthur lay there, dying, he asked a favor of Sir Bedivere, who was close by. He asked him to take Excalibur back to the lake where he had found it, and throw it back into the lake where it belonged. Bedivere accepted this quest, and despite hesitating for some time, eventually completed the task. As he threw the legendary sword back into the lake, a hand reached out of the lake and caught it. It was also on this lake where a barge containing three women appeared. Arthur was set upon this barge and floated down the river to the Isle of Avalon. Here his wounds were treated by three mysterious maidens. His body was never found, and many say that he rests under a hill with all his knights, ready to ride forth and save the country again when the need arises. So that is, in a nutshell, what would cover the life of the legendary King Arthur according to the tales told throughout the ages. There are various books, movies, and TV shows that show many different versions of some of the most famous tales, including Arthur. For a fun story showing Arthur's young childhood through being made king, I recommend Disney's The Sword in the Stone, a timeless classic that is a family-friendly and entertaining movie. For a lesser-known movie showing an interpretation of Guinevere and Lancelot's betrayal, as well as Arthur's late life and death, I recommend The First Knight, starring Sean Connery. And for everything in between, there are countless movies, TV shows, and books. But the ones I recommend the most are actually the Squire's Tales series and the Knight's Tale series of books by Gerald Morris. If you're truly interested in Arthurian legend, these simple yet very entertaining books are a great way to get into it and learn about the major players while picking up bits and pieces of the story along the way. But in any case, that's all we've got for today. I hope you liked this video and learned at least a little bit more about the King Arthur of legends in the process. But in any case, thanks for watching and have a nice day, and I'll see you next time.